Good morning, dear students. In this video lesson, we are going to have an analysis of the last chapter in the text Spectrum, Literature and Contemporary Issues. The chapter, which is titled Selections from the Cry of the Girl, is actually an excerpt or a part taken from the autobiography of the famous French actress Emmanuelle Laborit. The full text of the autobiography of Laborit is titled The Cry of the Girl, and you have only a selected part of the autobiography in this text. Before introducing the author, I would like to ask you a simple question. Is it possible for a child who is deaf by birth to speak? Deaf means not able to hear any sounds. He or she has no problem with his speaking. He is not dumb or is able to produce sounds, has no problems with his or her tongue and other speech organs. But since he or she is not able to hear any sounds when his parents or people around him speak, so he is not able to imitate their sounds. So my question is it possible for such a child to speak? So you have to ask this question to yourself and try to find out an answer. Here we have Emmanuelle Laborit, a deaf French actress who was born on 18th October 1971. Though she was hearing impaired by birth, she became a famous French actress who appeared in more than 10 French films since 1994. Some of her famous films are Mariana Ukria, An Air So Pure, Beyond Silence, and Still Leap. One of the most distinguishing accomplishments of Emmanuelle Laborit is her autobiography, The Cry of the Girl. She begins her autobiography with a simple explanation of the difference that the sign language has made in her life. With the help of sign language, she could understand that yesterday was behind her and tomorrow was in front of her. By learning this, she realized that being hearing impaired could be a positive part of her identity. Later, she decided to finish her schooling and fight for the rights of other deaf French people. Her autobiography is an encouraging story for young people everywhere. Now into the background story of the text. Selection from The Cry of the Girl is an excerpt from Emmanuelle Laborit's autobiography, The Cry of the Girl. This autobiography was also published in the second edition of the Disability Studies Reader, edited by Leonard J. Darris. Through this work, Laborit narrates the issues related with the disabled and how they overcome their difficulties. She describes parental attitude towards a disabled child and the need for training to change the attitude of the society as a whole. In this excerpt, the author focuses on the need of inclusion of the disabled and how to challenge the othering or discrimination experienced by the physically challenged group. In a previous chapter titled Average Ways in Unprotected Waters, we have seen how a mother of a disabled child gets rid of him. Instead of taking care of him and making him feel comfortable and thereby bringing him out of his disability, his mother leaves him behind and escapes from all her burdens. But here in this chapter, we find a mother who takes extreme care of her disabled child and helps the child overcome all her disabilities. This passage is noted for its motivational and optimistic mode. Now into the text. The excerpt begins with a first person narrative. Laborit remembers her childhood days and how she survived as a physically challenged one. Her parents discovered that she was deaf when she was 9 months old. Though it was a heartbreaking news, they never felt disappointed. Her screaming pierced their ears like the cries of a seagull, and so they nicknamed her Muette, which means seagull in French. Since the child was not able to speak, she used to make a shrieking sound to gather attention. The sound she made resembled the sound of a seagull. So her parents used the word Muette to call her. That means seagull in French. But the word Muette rhymed with the English word mute, which means silent or dumb. Labori's parents couldn't find out her disability in the beginning. For them, she was a disciplined child who could sleep without getting disturbed even by the blaring music in the next room where they had a party to entertain guests. Though she couldn't hear sounds, she was able to feel and react towards vibrations. It was her father's older brother, Uncle Fifo, who found out her deafness or her disability. Her parents soon consulted a pediatrician who tried some acts like slamming doors to check whether the baby could hear. Little Emmanuel reacted to the vibration, not to the sound. But the pediatrician thought that the child is reacting to the sounds and told her parents that she is normal and had no problems with her ears. Then they consulted a specialist who told them the truth that the child can't hear. They also consulted a specialist at Trousseau Hospital where they got confirmed of their child's disability. It was a terrible shock for her parents. Laborit says that her memories of her early childhood are fragmented. Her age up to 7 was full of gaps because she had only visual memories whose time frame she couldn't place. She only had daylight and darkness, no tomorrows, no yesterdays, no weeks, no months, and no years. Laborit's parents' love and unending support helped her to continue her life as that of a normal child. Their presence was enough to cope with her difficulties and hard times. Laborit's parents never worried about her differently abled condition. They never gave up Laborit in her struggling times. Instead, they always thought of new strategies for bringing her up as a normal child. They sent her to a speech therapist for learning how to communicate through Meissner method. They taught her to pronounce letters using mouth movements and hand gestures. Laborit's mother always spent her time for the disabled daughter to enable her to communicate with this world. She sat with her daughter during the training sessions. Thus, her mother could restart communicating with her. Sometimes her father felt really sad that he couldn't communicate with his daughter like his wife could do. Laborit remembers the efforts she has taken to utter a few words and her mother's commendable support in her journey through the hard times. Here the author reminds us the role of parents in molding up their children by accepting all her weakness or disabilities. She concludes the story by highlighting her mother's inspirational words. She may be deaf, but she is so cute. She'll just be that much smarter. Laborit here describes the pains and sufferings taken by her parents to enable the disabled daughter to face the world with a different attitude. The excerpt upholds a valuable message that proper parental attitude and the right kind of training can provide the disabled children a normal life. It also opens up issues like the struggle of the disabled to survive and varying social attitudes towards the disabled. It is a disability narrative which can function as a motivational piece. That's the end of this session. Thank you.